Good evening, moms and dads and grandpas and grandpas and brothers and sisters. We welcome you this evening to our evening worship service. This is not so much a children's Christmas program as it is a children's Christmas worship service in which our young people are going to lead us today. And so we pray that the Holy Spirit would do his work among us and that he would open our eyes not only to see him, but to respond to him out of the mouth of babes. Cameron is going to call us to worship tonight.
All God's people, boys, girls, women, and men.
Come and worship. Come and worship.
Shepherds, magi, saints, and angels.
Come and worship.
Come and worship.
All who need the Savior, all who long for comfort.
Come and worship. Come and worship Christ, the newborn King.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
Thank you. the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there's no room for that. We will be reading Isaiah 9:6.
To us a child is born.
To us a son is given.
And the government will be on his shoulders.
And he will be called Wonderful Counselor,
Mighty God,
Everlasting Father,
Prince of Peace.
Verses 1 through 14. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified.
But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord.
This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angels, praising God and saying,
"Gloria a Dios en las tierras paz, buena voluntad para con los hombres."
Joy, 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 joy,
Please pray with me. Dear Jesus, you come to bring peace on earth, but there are so many who do not have peace. Please make us instruments of your peace for families that are sad because someone they love has died, people who live in tents or on the streets because they have no home, kids around the world who don't have clean water or healthy food, families affected by the floods and tornadoes. Thank you for your promise of peace on earth and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger.
When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had said to them.
But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Think this little girl is doing? Looking out the window. Yeah, why do you think she's looking out the window? Think maybe, what did you say? I heard it, somebody here. She's waiting. Yeah, she looks to me like she's waiting. What do you think she's waiting for? It's hard to know, isn't it? Yes, what do you think?
The rain to stop.
The rain to stop, that's a good idea. Yes, we do a lot of that around here, don't we? I think she's looking, yeah, could be. What else do you think she might be waiting for when you look at that? Yes? Yeah, maybe she's waiting for her daddy to come home from work or mommy to come home. Yes, yes, what else? Waiting for God, maybe. Yes, Ethan? maybe waiting for Grandpa and Grandma to come. You know, when I look at that picture, what's that, Hall? Maybe she was waiting for aunt and uncle to come over. When I look at that picture, that's what I think. To me, this little girl looks like she's waiting for maybe her daddy to come home or maybe mom to come home. Could be her cousins, yeah. You know, we could go on all night, really. Could be a whole number of folks, right? Absolutely. Yeah. Do you think that if she was waiting for her dad to come home, that she would know when he did? I think she would. And I think that the reason that this little girl would know that daddy was home is because she knows exactly what daddy looks like. Like, for example, if the mailman came by and put mail in the mailbox, I don't think this little girl would say, "Oh, daddy's home." She would know, because she knows that her daddy's not the mailman. She is waiting and ready and will know immediately when daddy comes home from work. Did you know that there is a story, a Christmas story in the Bible about an old man, not a little girl, but an old man who had to do a lot of waiting. And this man was not only waiting, but he was ready for when Jesus came. And the story is found in Luke chapter 2. Now, you led us beautifully through what we know to be the Christmas story in Luke 2, but here's how the rest of the story goes. I'm going to read to you from verse 25 of Luke 2. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem called, does anybody know? Simeon. Yes. Who was a righteous and devout man. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took the baby in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all the people." Simeon spent a lot of time waiting, because God had told him that he was going to have a very special gift, that in his lifetime he was going to be able to see the promised Jesus Messiah with his very own eyes. And so day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, Simeon waited. And he waited. And he waited some more. And he waited. And then one day, a young couple came to the temple by the name of Mary and Joseph, and they brought this little boy to the temple, and immediately, like this little girl would know immediately that daddy was home, immediately Simeon recognized that this little boy was Jesus, the one who would save him from his sins. Simeon was ready. Simeon was very ready. And my question to you tonight is how was he ready? How could he be so ready? For example, how did he know to go to the temple just at the time that Mary and Joseph would come to the temple? How would old man Simeon know who Jesus was? He says, "This is the sovereign Lord." How would Simeon know what Jesus was coming to do? He says, "He's bringing salvation, not only for me, but for all the Gentiles." What made Simeon so ready? Do you know what the answer is? What? God. Yes. God, the Holy Spirit. Do you know that you can't be ready for Jesus without the Holy Spirit? How did he know to go to the temple on that day? Well, the verses that we read said that he was moved by the Holy Spirit and he went to the temple. How did he recognize that that little baby of all the babies was Jesus, the promised Messiah? Because we read it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit. And he knew that Jesus came to give salvation. How in the world did he know that? Well, the Bible that we read says the Holy Spirit was on him. Do you know that you cannot be ready for Jesus coming without the Holy Spirit? Do you know that we are also waiting for Jesus to come? No, we're not waiting for Jesus to come in Bethlehem to be Emmanuel, God with us. That happened many, many years ago. We are waiting for Jesus to come from heaven again as the King of Kings to take us to be with him. And the question I have to ask you is, are you ready for Jesus to come? We're waiting, but are we, like Simeon, going to be ready when he comes? What are we going to need to be ready for Jesus to come? The Holy Spirit. Bingo. We're going to need the Holy Spirit. And you know why we need the Holy Spirit? Because the Holy Spirit is like glasses. Yes, Miss Holland. To help us, indeed. To help us see. You know, it was a few years ago when I was reading the Bible in church, and I came home after church, and my family said, "Dad, you didn't read all the right words." And I said, "Sure I did." "No, you didn't." And lo and behold, I was beginning to realize I was going a little bit blind in my eyes. And so now I wear glasses to help me see, and if I don't, why, it's really hard to see who is who. Like, who is this guy right here? Who is this with the bow tie here? Wait, just a sec.
I'm Ethan.
Oh, that's Ethan. See, now I can see because I have my glasses on, right? The Holy Spirit is like glasses. The Holy Spirit helps us to see Jesus and to see Jesus for who he is. The Holy Spirit is the only one who can show us and give us eyes to see that Jesus Christ came to earth to die for our sins, to be buried in the tomb, to rise on the third day, to be ascended into heaven, and to come again to bring us to be with him. The Holy Spirit is like glasses, and for us to be ready, for us to recognize Jesus, who he is and what he does, we need whom? The Holy Spirit. But not only is the Holy Spirit like glasses, the Holy Spirit is also like gasoline. Gasoline, right? I know some of your daddies drive some pretty big trucks with some pretty big engines, very strong. But did you know that if you had the strongest motor in the world, but you didn't have gasoline, it wouldn't do a thing? You need gasoline in order to make that engine, that motor, move the truck. Do you know that that's exactly what the Holy Spirit does for us? We read that Simeon was in the temple, and the reason he went to the temple that day is because he was moved by the Holy Spirit. When Jesus comes, we want to be obeying Jesus and serving Jesus and loving Jesus. But you know what? Like a motor can't run without gasoline, we cannot love Jesus, we cannot serve Jesus, we cannot obey Jesus without the Holy Spirit. So what should we do to be ready? Number one, we ought to pray. Pray that the Holy Spirit would come into our hearts. Have you ever prayed that the Holy Spirit would give you eyes? Yes, Alan? You prayed that the Holy Spirit would come into your heart and help you see Jesus? But when you're four, it was wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. Pardon? Yes, you can. Absolutely. You can ask the Holy Spirit to give you eyes to see Jesus whenever, right? And so we want to pray. And then once we've prayed for the Holy Spirit to show us and help us see Jesus clearly, then we want to pray for the Holy Spirit to come into our hearts to empower us to serve and to love him. And you know what happens when you pray for the Holy Spirit? And you obey through the power of the Holy Spirit, you know what's going to happen? You're going to do exactly what Simeon did. Do you remember what he did when he came into the temple? He took baby Jesus and he praised the Lord. And boy, you've helped us do that tonight. And we're so thankful. So I'm going to ask that you would remember that for us to be ready for Jesus to come again, that we would pray for the Holy Spirit to give our eyes, that we would obey by the power that the Holy Spirit gives us, loving and serving Jesus, and that we would live our lives singing the praises of Jesus. Can you remember that? Pray, obey, praise. Can you say that with me? Pray, obey, praise. Amen. Let's pray, okay? Father in heaven, we give you thanks, Lord, for teaching us something through an old man named Simeon about how we can be ready for you to come again as he was ready for you to come to Bethlehem. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would give us eyes to see who Jesus is, why we need Jesus as our Savior. We pray that your Holy Spirit would open our eyes like glasses to see clearly that Jesus came to die for our sins, rose again from the dead, is ascended in heaven, and is coming back to take us to be with him. And we pray, Jesus, until then, that you would empower us like gasoline in our engines to serve you and to love you and to honor you and to praise you. And we will give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, family and friends, our children want to invite you to come downstairs. There's plenty of room for everybody, but to come downstairs and to enjoy a meal with us. All right? And so we're not quite done with our service yet, but our children are actually going to exit right now and go and prepare the food for us. And so we'll wait for them to do that. And as they do that, we're going to conclude our service together before we make our way downstairs. You know, friends, I imagine that if you were able to talk to Simeon and asked him about that day, he'd probably say something like, "Oh, you, what a day that was. The day that I went to the temple and I saw Jesus face to face. I beheld with my own eyes, the very Christ, my Savior. When I saw him, I was ready and eager to go. My servant can die in peace." When we think about Jesus coming again, that's the longing of our heart as well, an eager anticipation. And with Simeon at his first advent, we say with his second, "What a day, what a day that shall be when my Jesus I shall see." And Emily and Dina and Sarah and Melissa are going to sing that song for us. And I invite you to join them as we come to the final chorus.
The one who saved me by his grace, when he no pain, no more parting over there, and forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be.
What a day.
Thank you, ladies. I invite you to join me as we not only give thanks to the Lord at this Advent time for his sure and certain coming again, but also his provision until then. Let's join our heads in prayer. Gracious God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who in fulfillment of all the promises of old, in the fullness of time, was born of a woman, we give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for all of the promises that you will come again to take us to be with you, and what a day that will be. May we live as Advent people, eager and ready to love and to live our lives for you. By the power of your Holy Spirit who lives in us, we thank you that you're coming again, and we thank you that until then, you give us all that we stand in need of. And so tonight we thank you for the food that we are about to eat. We give you praise, from whom all good things come. We thank you for the hands that have prepared this meal. We thank you for the little hands that will serve this nourishment. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for the sweet blessing of your fellowship as we break bread together. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, and all God's children say, Amen. The Lord bless you. Let's enjoy a meal together.